God have a plan? Has he made a way? Oh, he is still provision, amen? He is still provision. Many will say, Jehovah Jireh, my provider. But really what the Bible says is, I am provision. I am what you need right when you need it. Where? I am exactly what you need. I am shepherd. I am provision. Thank you so much. Amen. And you kept me out of trouble, see. Had they had to get up there and share by themselves, it would have been a cold ride home. That better not have been your idea, Deacon Washington. Amen. Lord, have mercy. She's going to say, how did they know I can sing? Anybody sitting around you, baby? Anybody sitting around you, amen. Bless the Lord. I give glory and honor to God. Honor to the angel of this house, amen. Pastor Davis, hallelujah. To my brethren in the ministry, amen. And actually, Pastor Davis and I share military service, amen. To my brother in the military also. I give honor to those of you that have come and to the man of God that is serving today. Here in this house. Grace and peace be unto you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God always upon every remembrance of you, making mention of you constantly in my prayers. Since I was asked to come, I began praying. He gave me not even knowing what the passion of my life is, he gave me the message, rise up, O men of God. Since you don't know my wife is called to lead women, and I am called to lead men. And so this was right up my alley and excited me from the beginning, amen. I'm amazed at how God lines stuff up. God has a plan. And his plan is always better than ours. By about 3 o'clock when the music starts, I should be just clumping. So, amen. Let's ask God to bless. Father, I quiet myself before you, because in your presence, I always ask myself, why am I talking? I pray now, God, that you would fill me again with your spirit and allow not this leaky vessel to be the failure today. I pray for these your lambs who will hear your word. I ask you to prepare all of our hearts so that we might receive it. And then, God, make us different because of it. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
So I've come today, and you've already heard my subject text read in your hearing. The subject text is 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 11 through 16. And I know that the key verse for this particular day is 11 and 12. But I felt it important when we talk about rising up, O men of God, that we would take some time and give some reasons for the rise. Come on. And so a charge to men of God is what Paul does here in the last chapter of the book of his letter to his first letter to Timothy. He sets a bunch of charges from the beginning of the chapter. Then he gets down to really his seminal verses, amen. He gets down to the real charge, and he ends in verse 10 with, don't be greedy. And at the beginning of the chapter, he says, don't follow false teachers. And so when we start to look, and we need to understand that he says, he
God. Are you workmen that doesn't need to be ashamed? You know, we need to, first of all, before we rise up, we got to hear what God is saying to us. That title, man of God, is used rarely in Scripture. It's used around 6 times in the Old Testament, only twice in the New Testament. Man of God, it's a distinction. There's a distinction, there's a challenge in the title itself. I'm a man. You remember the first time you said that to your parents or to the adults? I'm a man. I didn't become a man until I became a man of God. Hallelujah. There's a distinction. Only a few were called man of God. Moses was called a man of God. Samuel was called a man of God. Shemaiah the prophet was called a man of God. Elijah was called a man of God. Elisha was called a man of God. And then Timothy was called a man of God twice. It's a distinction. Don't use it lightly. He says there's a distinction to that. Then, oh man of God, there's a devotion to being a workman.
That's right.
I need you to understand these are really pastoral epistles. He's writing pastorally to Timothy. And so this man of God is really the minister of the word, the pastor. Let me tell you something. The word minister is diakonos. It means servant. Anybody that wants to work in the church wants to become a servant. So I'm a man of God. You're a man of God. You're a man of God. And ladies, you need to be devoted to the word also. So I'm going to say y'all are men of God too. Come on. We are all in God's army. God is no respecter of person. Rise up. Oh, man of God, because you're distinguished. Because you need to be devoted. And there's a duty. There's a duty in the title. So before we can even talk about fleeing, fighting, and following, we've got to talk about the duty. I got to know that he says, as for you, man of God. Get up because I called you by your title. Get up because I distinguished you by calling you that. Get up because I give you a sense of devotion, and get up because you have a sense of duty.
You're doing all right.
You are a man of God.
Amen.
Not a man for yourself.
Amen.
Not called to serve yourself.
Amen.
Not called to serve. Let me just tell you.
That's right.
You're serving God. Many of us serve the church like it is God.
That's right.
Can I get a witness? The duty is to God. So there's a distinction, there's a devotion, there's a duty just to get to being a man of God. That title says you, man of God. Flee! So there's 3 things we want to talk about in this charge in verses 11 and 12. 3 of them. There's free, flee, follow, and fight. But you got to rise up before you can flee. You got to rise up before you can follow. Can I get a witness? You can't sit and flee. You can't sit and fight. You can't sit and follow. So he says, flee these things. And so the question, first of all, we got to ask, what do I mean by flee? Flee is a quick answer.
That's right.
What am I fleeing?
I
already talked about it. Apostasy and avarice. Apostasy, following false teachers. Avarice, following after greed. Flee greed. Flee apostasy. Flee the false teachers. Flee the lust for money. He says the love of money is the root of all kinds.
That's right.
It's a root sin.
Amen.
Flee that root sin.
He says,
flee is a quick answer. It's not, how many times, see, we say stuff like, that's like a car wreck, you can't turn away.
Amen.
It's like a train wreck, I got to stop and see.
I got to
take my time and look at it. I got to look, I got to watch, I got to know what's going on. We are so nosy.
Yes, we are.
We wind up getting sullied.
Yes, we are.
By what we're watching.
That's right.
By what we take time to notice.
Yeah, yeah.
He says, make a to know is many of the, why do I need to get up?
All right.
Rise up.
Yeah.
Oh, man of God. Rise up so you can get your stride on.
That's right.
Rise up. You can't flee sitting there looking.
Yes, right.
You can't run sitting there.
Yeah.
You got to rise up.
Yeah.
Oh, some of us ain't got nothing so long, we're going to have to take a while stretching.
Come on.
You got to stretch or I'm going to get a cramp trying to flee. Some of us have not fleeing. We haven't run from anything in so long.
Yeah.
So long that we're going to knot up and tear something.
Right.
So get up.
Amen.
Stretch it out.
Stretch out.
And get ready to make a quick exit.
Amen.
Oh, the next thing he says. He says, flee these things. Then he says, pursue. I got to follow.
That's right.
So you got to flee and then you got to follow. But remember, you can't follow sitting down.
That's right.
You can't come after me just sitting down.
That's right.
You got to follow by getting up. You got to
rise up.
And follow.
Right.
This word pursue, this word follow. Follow righteousness.
Yes.
This word is to pursue earnestly. That means to chase it down.
Yes.
To not let it get out of your sight.
Yeah.
That means to keep it always in front of you.
Yeah.
Even though it's trying to get away from you, keep it on after. You know, a wolf will chase a deer until the deer's heart bursts. They'll run and run and run until the deer can't run no more. This word pursue is about us getting the wind to be able to keep on going, even though righteousness seems to be out of our reach.
Yeah.
Oh, can I get a witness?
That's right.
You're
doing all right.
Let me just tell you. So the character of it, the character of our pursuit, the character of our following is earnestly.
Yeah.
It's earnestly.
Amen.
But then what am I following?
Amen.
Oh, we're following the tenets of godly living.
Amen.
The things of the world and we follow
the
tenets of godly living.
Yeah, amen.
Oh, look at what he says. He says righteousness.
Yes.
Amen.
He says godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, gentleness.
That's right.
For those of you that are preachers in the house, amen.
Can I
pretty this up a little bit? Go ahead. A little alliteration.
Go ahead.
Righteousness being sanctity.
Yeah.
Godliness being sacredness.
Yeah.
Faith being surety.
Yeah.
Love being sentiment. Oh, can I get a witness? Steadfastness, just leave it right there, because that's an answer.
That's right.
Leave it right there. And then you have generosity. You have gentleness, which is submission.
Yes.
Can I get a witness? When I look, he tells me that I've got to follow after the things demonstrate a godly life.
Yeah.
You've got to rise up in order to live a godly life. See, the enemy, I told this to my church just a couple weeks ago, just a week ago.
Amen.
The devil doesn't want to kill you.
That's right.
He just wants to make you ineffective.
Yeah.
He just wants to take your power away from you.
Right.
He wants to destroy your testimony.
Right.
He wants to take away your ability to impact someone on the Lord.
Yeah.
He wants to eliminate your God-given ability to make an impression on somebody. He wants to take away everything the devil wants to kill us.
No.
You see, armies are not made by killing.
Yeah.
All that does is make folk back home angry.
Yeah.
But if I can wound you and make you sit down on the battlefield,
that's right.
I can convince you to just sit down, old man of God.
Yeah.
And I can say, old man of God, you just sit down.
That's right.
Amen.
You just stay right there. You already saved.
Yeah, that's right.
You already going to heaven. You on your way to glory. Just sit on down and wait for the great by and by. It don't take all that. That's what the enemy wants us to say. He wants it don't take all that.
Amen.
You just sit right there. You know the promise. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So why are you working so hard?
Now,
here we go with the stretching again.
All right,
here we go. Mm-hmm. Here we go. It's all about speed. I got to run after this thing. Which means I got to, now y'all see me, right? If I get ready to run, I got to stretch it out. And when I was in the Marine Corps, we used to call it the recon shuffle. That's just that 6-inch stride, because that's about all the running I'm going to do. But I'm moving, and I'm up, and I'm pursuing at my pace, the best I can do. Let me just tell you, just because I ain't running as fast as you, don't mean I ain't running. Some of us do, but we got to keep pace with each other. That's not the case.
That's right.
God requires us to set a pace, and then keep it.
Yeah.
The secret to finishing a marathon is not to sprint in the beginning. It's to get a pace and keep it until the end. Hallelujah. Let's not get into the sweat. Let's get into the storm. But he that endureth, before you can follow, you got to rise up. You got to rise up. My verse right here. Fight.
Yes.
How many of y'all tried to fight in the chair?
Yeah.
Try to fight in the chair. Come on, sit down there. See how well you fight. See how much distance you got. What your footwork look like in a chair. How much bobbing and weaving can you do in a chair? This is my verse right here because I got to rise up and fight.
Now,
this is not pugnaciousness.
Yeah.
This is not me getting up and trying to fight everything and everybody that comes around me. That's not what this is. This is about contending with aggression for the faith. Can I get a witness? I got to contend. This is an athletic word right here. This is about the word here really is agar. It's a word that means agony. It means the real struggle. It means the struggle.
Yeah.
See, this again is where the enemy says, it don't take all that. It don't take all that. I don't know how long you've been saved. I've been saved 34 years. I've been preaching 32 years. When I look at somebody, they asked me just a couple weeks ago, sitting in the study, Pastor David, sitting in the study, looking at me like I'm the okie doke.
That's right.
How do you know the word like that? Because I've been saved 34
years.
And saved for me meant that God says, study to show thyself approved. A workman, a man of God, is not to be ashamed. Right there, cutting it straight.
That's right.
Now, fight.
Right.
doesn't make you the judge.
That's right.
Or the jury.
Amen.
Or the executioner.
Amen.
Or
the
witness there. Many of us think fighting for the faith means we got to confront our neighbor.
Come on.
Amen.
And confront to us means condemn.
Yeah, that's right.
I wish I had a witness.
Yeah.
I wish I had a witness right there.
Yeah.
Confront to us means condemn.
Yeah.
I just had to say something.
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, did you just have to say something?
Yeah.
They think that that's the fight. Yeah. All that is starting a fight.
Yeah.
Come on. I have a witness. I knew where they were going. I just had to say something. I said, did you ask permission first?
That's right.
Because I'm grown.
Yeah.
You don't get to just speak. Oh, it's freedom of speech yet over there. Over in your house.
That's right.
Over in your personal space.
That's right.
You can shout anything you want, just don't shout it at me.
Yeah.
We think that fighting for the faith means we confront our neighbors, and we use confront for condemn.
Amen.
I don't see coming. Jesus came into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And if I'm going to demonstrate the grace and love of God, found in the cross of Christ, I've got to get condemnation out of my mouth.
That's right.
Fight. But fight right. Look. When I counsel married couples, y'all don't mind me. Oh, Jesus. Take a breath. When I fight, when I counsel married couples, I want to teach them three things. I teach them about money. I counsel them about sex. And I teach them how to fight. I teach them what not to say. I teach them what to say. I tell them what words are off limits. I teach them how to go to their corners until the bell rings. I teach them to keep their hands up. I teach them to realize when the round should be ended. And everybody needs to take a break. You got to learn how to fight. Here's the problem. We don't spend enough time in God's word to know how to fight. So, many of us are too embarrassed to fight. I don't know enough. You know that you got saved, and you know how. So teach what you know.
Yeah.
And then there are some of us that think we know it all. We get in and we don't fight fair. And the only one that winds up beat up is the name of God. Oh, let me say that again. The only one that winds up beat up is the name of God. Because I'm going to walk away. I told her.
Yeah,
she gonna walk away. She better not ever say that to me again.
That's right.
Fight! Look at what he says. The good fight.
That's right.
This word fight. The good fight of the faith.
Of the faith.
Peace does. Of the trust. Of the leaning on and knowing that it's always going to be there. The substance of things hoped for. The evidence of things unseen. Getting that good testimony as the patriarchs did. Moses by faith. Abraham by faith. Sarah by faith. Y'all don't hear me today. The fight of faith is about us first of all sharing the gospel. That's our mandate. Our mandate from God is not to confront sin. Our mandate from God is to share the gospel of Christ found on the cross of Christ.
That's right.
On Calvary's Hill was gospel.
Yeah.
If I'm busy fighting you about what you're doing, I can't get you to the cross.
Yeah.
The fight of faith, contending against false teaching.
Amen.
Yeah.
I'll leave y'all alone. My wife said, right, here you go. But I'm not a blabbering, grab it, name it, and claim it man. I'm a man that believes that the scripture is true. But I believe in the truth of scripture. And that doctrines aren't built on single verses. And promises of God are not taken out of context. Oh, I wish I had a witness now. I will fight the fight of faith.
but it only comes because I understand my mandate.
Right.
And I will stand against false teaching.
Yes.
I'm not standing against a person. I'm standing against false teaching.
Yes.
I'm
Wow.
Amen.
Fight the fight of faith.
Amen.
Rise up in your faith.
Yes.
Rise up and fight.
Amen.
Now, many of us are tired. We got tired early on.
Amen.
It was easy to get tired.
Amen.
Because we kept telling ourselves it don't take all that.
Yeah.
I just want to get along.
Yeah, yeah. That's right.
I don't want to hurt nobody.
That's right, that's right.
I don't want nobody to be mad.
Amen,
at me.
Amen.
Let me tell you something. There are people going to hell because of what they believe.
Yes.
Not because of what they're doing.
Yes.
Not because of where they're going.
Yes.
Not because of what they call themselves.
Yes.
They're going to hell because of what they believe.
Yes.
And if I am unable to affect what they believe, I am not fighting for the faith.
Right.
We spend too much time trying to share our denomination.
Yeah.
We spend too much time pointing at the Pentecostal.
Yeah.
We spend too much time talking about homosexuality.
Yeah.
We spend too much time worrying about same-sex marriage.
Yeah.
I need to tell you what we believe. Entrepreneurs. entrepreneurs in the faith are folks that are willing to leave the comfort of their home and move overseas in a foreign land and serve God there for pennies. Oh, see, you got quiet. Because many of us have a penny ante faith. You take what I mean by that. When we understand that we are living eternally already,
amen,
we can serve wherever God calls.
Yes, yes.
Amen.
We can go wherever He sends.
Yes.
Oh, I wish I had a witness.
Praise it's okay.
Him.
It's okay. My conduct is I'm going to lay hold, I'm going to grab my eternal life.
Yes.
My cause is eternal life. The reason that I'm laying hold of my faith is because of the eternal life that He has given me. Let me tell you something. To understand the death that we were in prior to meeting Christ, we have to understand the life that we have.
Praise Him.
Oh, some of us will die sick. And we'll say, we'll stand up here and folks will pray over us and we won't get well. But don't lose hope because I'm healed.
Yeah.
And this side,
yeah,
all the other.
Because
my life has no end.
Right.
So whether He heals me here or He heals me there, I might be in that great getting up morning.
Right.
Where there's no more weeping and no more crying, where there's no more death. But God Himself will be my God. And He will drive the fear from my eyes on the stand here.
Yeah.
Someday before God. On this side or the other, because it doesn't matter. Time has no meaning to those that have eternal life.
Hallelujah.
Look what He says. Look what He says. Look what He says. First of all, we have to understand the faith that is spoken of in the Word. And so He says, take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and about which you made a good confession in the presence of many witnesses. There's a calling for men of God to stand on faith. There's a calling for men of God. We have been called to eternal life.
Yes.
And what we have to understand is that there's no death that can occur on the battlefield that will end our life.
Yes.
These are all battle words. These are all battle words. And then the confession. There must be a confession. A confession of eternal life. As standing and saying, I believe that Jesus died for me. I believe that He was raised again from the dead. I believe that He ascended into heaven. I believe that He's coming again to judge the quick and the dead. I believe!
Yes.
I believe that He died for me.
Yes.
And then He's, look. The last thing that He points us to is Christ.
Amen.
And without Christ, there's no getting up. There's no great getting up morning.
Yeah.
I don't know what y'all can. I'm not a hooper. So y'all waiting for that. He says, I charge you in the presence of God in verse 13, who gives life to all things and of Christ Jesus, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who in His testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession to keep the commandment unstained and free from approach unto the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which He will display at the proper time, He who is the blessed and the only sovereign, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, who dwells in unapproachable light, who no one has ever seen or can see. To Him be honor and eternal dominion.
Yes.
Rise up, O men of God, and know your Christ.
Yes.
Know the Christ of the Word.
Amen.
He says we have to keep care of the Word. Preserve the Word. Look at this. He says, keep it. Keep the commandment. Care for it. Keep it pure in purity. Preserve it. Make sure it's in purity, unstained. See, here's what's happened to us. We have allowed the dye of the world to stain the cloth of the gospel.
Yes, yes.
We call it progressiveness. We cloak it in secular language. And say, that was then, but this is now.
Now, I don't see any change in the Word of God. The Word of God is very, very clear. Jesus Christ is saying yesterday, today, and
Sir.
We have allowed ourselves to become stained with false gospel and false teachers. We've allowed ourselves to worship men and worship creatures rather than the Creator who is blessed forever. We've allowed ourselves to allow the uttering of the world to stain our robes. We come in stained and dusty from the roads we walk on, and we think it's all right to bring that filth in the church.
That's right.
Keep it unstained. Look. And then there's preservation, there's purity, and then there's praise, free from reproach. So this word free from reproach speaks of the insult. And so the opposite of that would be there must always be praiseworthiness in our care of the word, in our Christ. We must always be bringing him praise instead of bringing him reproach. The greatest insult to the name of God is us. The word hypocrite means mask wearer. So, Daryl hasn't ever seen me in this role, but he's seen me grit my teeth. So I have this smiling face, but watch this. Pull it off. That's who we are. That's who we are. Why? Because we hide our imperfection, thinking that that brings glory to God.
Praise
if I know, what have I got to talk about?
Right now.
Transparency.
Amen.
You know what the dream church is for me? I'll tell you what the dream church is. Some of y'all say, oh no, Lord Jesus, no. A church where I can stand up and confess my sin.
Oh, hallelujah.
Yeah.
And not be judged.
That's right.
And not hear it again.
That's right.
Oh, Doc, you know you're a lifesaver, right? I'm moist up here. What happens is that the world looks at us and says, you're nothing but hypocrites.
That's right.
You're standing here saying one thing, and I've seen you do another.
That's right.
We bring the greatest reproach upon the name of God. I'm almost done. I know I've gone way past my time. I'm so sorry.
That's all right.
Preservation, purity, praise, and for what period? Until his appearing. Blessed appearing of Christ. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Rise up, O men of God, and live a life fleeing from those things that Paul testifies of, following and pursuing righteousness and those tenets of godly living, fighting the fight of the faith, holding the word of God until his appearing. Remember, you are distinguished.
Amen.
And you're called to a life of devotion and duty. Do not allow anyone to let you think that you are less than what God has called you. God, rise up.
Rise up.
And live out your calling. Because he has lived for you.
Praise God.
And died for you.
Praise God.
And is now sitting at the right hand of God, making advocacy. We have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. So no matter how you fail or how you fall, let me tell you what Paul says. I am fully convinced that neither height, nor depth, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor any other created thing can separate me from the love of God found in Jesus Christ. Man of God! Don't think your fall knocks you off the box. Man of God, don't think when you're down that you are not still a man of God. Get up! Get up! Please! Follow and fight!
are his army.
Yes, we are. Yes, we are.
And our mandate is not to destroy. God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. He has committed unto us the word of reconciliation.
Amen.
Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. We beseech you on behalf of God. We beseech you on behalf of Christ, be ye reconciled to God. This is your mandate. Men of God, take the word of reconciliation to the world. And let them know that the cross of Christ is the bridge to heaven. You might be here today and you don't know him. You don't know a word I've said. I might as well be speaking Greek. Let me just share with you for just a second. I believe that the gospel is as simple as the ABCs.
Yes, it is.
It really is. Agree with God that you're a sinner, A.
Yes.
Agree with him that you're a sinner. Admit your sin to him.
Yes, that's right.
B, believe that Jesus died for you.
Yes.
Believe that Jesus died on the cross for you. And believe that he was raised again from the dead, A, B. C, confess him as your Savior. Confess him as your Savior. What does that mean, Pastor? It starts with a prayer. God, I am a sinner. Forgive me for my sin.
Yeah, that's right.
Save me.
That's right.
I believe that Jesus died for me, and I believe that he's raised again. A, B, C, D. Do it now.
Amen.
Because tomorrow is not promised.
That's right. That's right.
With the permission of the pastor.
All right.
If we could rise to our feet for a short while, every saved heart in the house is praying. Somebody's on the precipice of decision this morning. Somebody wants to make a decision for Christ. We're not looking to embarrass you. We're not looking to put you on the spot. But if you're here today and you don't know Jesus, I want to offer you him this morning. Come up and pray with us. We'll introduce you to Christ. We'll partner you with someone here that will walk with you as you grow in your faith. Will you come? Will you come to Jesus today? Will you accept the free gift of God found in the cross of Christ? Will you allow his blood to wash you clean? Will you be removed from your guilt? Will you be removed from your shame? Will you allow all of that to fall on him so that you can rise up clean? I didn't say you had to change anything. I didn't say you had to get rid of anything. I didn't say you had to dress a certain way. I said just come.